acceptance for you at the table of the Lord. There is acceptance for you. No matter who you are, the mercy of the Father is greater than your sin.
Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your Sabbath, for the Sabbath day and for the Sabbath rest, and for the privilege to share your word with your people. We ask that you lead us through this devotion. You speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to be reading from the book of Genesis chapter 18, and I'm reading from verse 9 to verse 15. Then they said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" And he said, "There in the tent." He said, "I will surely return to you at this time next year. And behold, Sarah, your wife, will have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. Sarah was past childbearing. Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have become old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also?" And the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, 'Shall I indeed bear a child when I am so old?' Is anything too difficult for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you at this time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah denied it, however, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. And he said, "No, but you did laugh." And this is the word of the Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I wish to speak to you this morning under the caption, "This time next year." The passage of scripture that we have read is about a miracle child born to Sarah and Abraham. This is a miracle child because Abraham was about 99 years old when the boy was born, and Sarah about 90 years old when the son was born. The question is, is there anything too difficult for the Lord? Seems to be answered by the conception of Isaac, by his birth, by his life, and the generations of Isaac. Throughout the history of the life of Isaac, it seems that God is answering this question: is there anything too hard for the Lord to do? Well, the answer is obvious. There's nothing too hard for the Lord to do. We testify to this because of the interactions that the Lord has had with his people throughout the years. God has allowed the world to run on natural laws such as cause and effect. It means if I expose my hand to excessive heat, I will be burned. We expect for that to happen. And God has also allowed the world to run on some generally accepted scientific laws. For instance, we agree on the gravitational force. If I throw something up, it will surely come down. So there are those scientific laws and there are those natural laws. So we expect as human beings that when we do certain things, certain specific outcomes will result. We expect that things will run this way. That's how our minds operate. But in the story, Sarah has passed the age of childbearing. Abraham is also old. They are no longer expecting to have their biological child, a child of their own. And then God says to them, this time, next year, Sarah will be holding a son in her hands. Although God allows the world to run through natural laws and some scientific laws that we generally accept, but there is a way that God comes to his children from an unexpected angle, and that's through miracles. A miracle is God's intervention, God's extraordinary intervention in human lives. When God comes from an angle we never expected he will. We know that when the children of Israel left Egypt, going to the promised land, they came across the Red Sea, the soldiers of Pharaoh were behind them, and the sea was in front of them. They were threatened, their lives were threatened, they thought they would die. But God intervened in that situation. When Moses called unto him, God parted the Red Sea. Scientific laws, natural laws cannot account for that, but God's extraordinary intervention helped them succeed. In the story of the wedding at Cana, the miracle, Jesus' first miracle, Jesus turned water into wine. That's God's extraordinary intervention in human lives. We know how Jesus healed the sick, how Jesus restored the sight of the blind. When Bartimaeus called unto Jesus, "Thou Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me," God, Jesus restored his sight. The woman with the issue of blood, who had been struggling for 12 years, when she touched the hem of Jesus' garment, that was God's extraordinary intervention in her life. All this cannot be accounted for by the natural laws and the scientific laws. It's God coming from an unexpected angle to hear the call of his children crying out of desperation. When the disciples' lives were threatened and the sea was boisterous and the boat was tossing and they cried frantically to Jesus Christ, "Do you not care that we perish?" Jesus calmed the storm. So what is a miracle? An extraordinary intervention from God in human lives. And so God was saying to Sarah and to Abraham, "You are advanced in age now. You are old. You don't think you'll have a child. But I want to tell you, there is nothing too hard for the Lord to do. Don't we appreciate this God? Don't we love this God? The God who hears our prayers. The God who answers our prayers. The God who administers to our desperate needs. We love such a God. And have you heard us sharing testimonies with our friends, with our neighbors, when we talk of this mighty God? The God who deals with our situation in the here and the now. But I want to share something with you today. That in as much as these miracles were exciting, the miracle of the turning of the water into wine, the miracle of parting the Red Sea, the miracle of restoring the sight of the blind, the miracle of the woman who touched the hem of Jesus' garment, those miracles are beautiful. We appreciate them. We get excited at them. But God does not always work with those instant miracles. The difference with this miracle of the child is that Jesus is saying, God is saying to Abraham and to Sarah, the guarantee is there that you will have a child, you will hold a child in your hands next year, this time. This miracle is not an instant miracle. The results are not instant. The miracle requires patience. And therefore, Sarah needed to be patient. Abraham needed to be patient. There was participation required from Abraham and from Sarah. They needed to be together, to sleep together, so that the child can be born. Some of the things that we pray for, some miracles that we require from the Lord, will definitely require our participation. And so, Sarah needed to be with her husband. Sarah needed to sleep with her husband. And Sarah needed to fall pregnant. This could not be outsourced to someone else. Earlier, Sarah had made a surrogate procedure when Ishmael was born. But in this case, she could not have delegated this responsibility. It is Sarah who had to be pregnant. It is Sarah who had to experience nauseas and who had to vomit, have those experiences. It is Sarah who had to change her diet. It is Sarah who had to adapt to new sleeping positions. It is Sarah who had to experience cravings and mood swings. The pregnancy had to be carried by Sarah herself. Patience was needed. Sarah's feet had to be swollen. It is Sarah who had to change the dress sizes. You are the one to be physically out of shape for you to enjoy this miracle. Whatever you experience, Sarah, the extra fat, the stretch marks, the scars from the cesarean section, it is you who must go through it. It cannot be delegated. For us to receive some of the wonders of life, we've got to understand that we need to be patient. It will not always be an instant thing. God has the ability to answer our prayers now and here. But in some instances, God says the miracle is guaranteed. The miracle is definite. But next year, this time. Of course, the miracle was intended to strengthen and build the faith of Abraham and Sarah, so that even their children can learn that faith is important for survival in the relationship with God. The process was burdensome on the old couple. It was burdensome, especially on the old lady. That's why she even laughed. She did not expect it, because the laws of nature that she knew, the cause and effect, the logic and the reason said, you will no longer fall pregnant. But when God intervened, through his extraordinary ways, the old lady fell pregnant and the child was born. Certain miracles are guaranteed in our lives, but we need patience to get there. We cannot just do it on our own. It cannot just be instant. God has to intervene, but our patience, brothers and sisters, our patience gets tested. In order for you to celebrate the product, you need to endure the process. The process transforms you. The process strengthens you. You've got to go through it yourself. You cannot delegate it. It must work in you. It must work on you, however painful, so that when you hold that bundle of joy in your hands, you can say, indeed, God is good. I'm talking to the young people now and everyone else who's busy with their studies. I want to say to you, the fact that you are registered at school, the fact that you are registered at college, the fact that you are at the university, that in itself is a miracle. But you've got to endure the process. On your graduation day, the tears of the mother, the tears of the father, and the tears of the student alike are as a result of the long hours of patience, the sacrifices of finances, the stress of the transport and the bus and the taxis and the rain. But on that graduation day, when you hold on to that certificate of yours, you realize the importance of waiting and the importance of patience. The miracle is guaranteed. Your graduation day is coming, but you need to endure the process so that you can celebrate the product. I want to talk to people who are in business. At this moment of COVID-19, they are wondering what will happen to their businesses. They are struggling. They don't see tomorrow. They don't see the future. The natural laws of cause and effect, of logic and reason, say you cannot make it. You are doomed. I want to tell you, this time, next year, something will be happening. COVID-19 will be history. Just as HIV and AIDS is now almost history, just as leprosy is now history, I want to assure you, the God of Jesus Christ, who works in mysterious ways, who allowed COVID-19 to happen, will come from an unexpected angle. That God will come in his extraordinary ways and intervene in human life, and COVID will be away. Hang on to that business idea. Hang on to that proposal. Be patient with the Lord. Go down on your knees. Never give up hope. Your miracle is coming. Patience is required. I'm talking to people who are in marriages. Maybe you have gone through a lot of pain, a betrayal, some hurt, and you don't know what to do anymore. You have run out of ideas. I want to say to you, maybe it's time that you just kneel down, pray, and wait. Wait, my brother. Wait, my sister. Hang in there. Who knows that the Lord, after your storm, will elevate you and your spouse to heights never imagined before. Oh, how we lost a lot of important things. How we lost a lot of valuable things, valuable relationship between siblings, between parents, between cousins, between spouses, only because of our failure to wait. We have sacrificed a lot of miracles of what could have been because we are failing to wait. I'm saying to you, the miracle is indeed coming. This time, next year, your story will be different. When he wishes God, he answers instantly. He performs now and then. But sometimes he allows you to go through a process so that you can celebrate at the end. I'm talking to parents and single parents who raise children. Oh, how difficult it is to raise a child. When they are young, when they are babies, when they are toddlers, they are such a joy. And as a parent, you've got ideas, you are excited by the fact that there will be this in life, there will be that in life. You sacrifice financially, you sacrifice your time, you try your best to raise them well. When they become teenagers, you see them experiencing with hubbly bubbly, with dacha, with alcohol and drugs. And you say to yourself, what have I done to deserve this? I want to say to you, do not give up on your children. Hang in there. Be patient with them. Continue to talk to them. Continue to pray for them. But don't throw them in the dustbin. For he is faithful that promised. The miracle to bring Abraham and Sarah taught them patience. Taught them that it can still be done by God when you least expect it. And so we realize that Sarah dies and Abraham dies. Many years pass, and in the book of Hebrews, when Paul is told by God of who the heroes and heroines are, the name of Abraham comes up. The name of Sarah comes up. Brothers and sisters, they are then regarded as the father. Abraham is regarded as the father of faith because he exercised patience. Is it not wonderful that what Sarah had given up on, that hope that she had abandoned, God raised and God elevated. And even long after their death, God still remembers their names. And God still whispers in the ears of his apostles and in the ears of his evangelists the name of Abraham and Sarah. Now, when you look at these heroes and heroines who are mentioned in the book of Hebrews, you realize that there were people like you and I. They had their difficulties. They had their experiences. Some painful. They were confronted with the challenges of life. Like you and I. They had their time with leprosy. They had their time with diseases they did not understand. They had their time with blindness. They had their time with disappointments. But it's like there was something common with all of them. That though they did their best to face the challenges they had, but they held on to one thing. There was one common thing with all of them. They looked for a city whose architect and builder is God himself. They knew that they were pilgrims and exiles in this world. They were looking for that heavenly city. They knew somehow that they would connect with the master, connect with their creator, and they so longed for that day to come. That is what kept them going. So inasmuch as we have our struggles now with our health conditions, we are going through problematic health conditions. We are experiencing diabetes. We are experiencing hypertension. We are experiencing cancer. We are experiencing COVID-19. We are struggling with HIV and AIDS. We are having financial difficulties. We've got debts. We've got employment issues, employment insecurities. We've got problems with our businesses. Inasmuch as we are going through that, we need to be like these heroes and heroines. And we need to not be derailed by the challenges that face us. We must endeavor to work on them. We must endeavor to do something about them. We must endeavor to improve in this world. But all that should not derail our focus from the common and the ultimate goal of the Christendom, of all the Christians of all ages. And that is the hope of the coming of the Lord. Indeed, while we work on earth and on these challenges, let us not lose our focus. Let us not lose our sight of the city that is coming. When we talk about the city that is coming, people tend to think that we are not concerned of the issues in this world. Yes, we are. We want social justice. We want social cohesion. We want prosperity, including the land. But we should not focus that much on the things that are here and forget that we are pilgrims and exiles in this world. We are looking for the city whose architect and builder is God himself. So what kind of God do we serve? We serve a God who's able to answer our prayers when we are desperate in the here and now. We experience him in the story of the Israelites when they were faced with the Red Sea. We serve the God who's able to turn water into wine, who is there here and now. But that is the same God that can say, you will have it, but not now. Be patient, wait. Only next year, this time, will you experience it. But what do you do while waiting? While waiting, brother, while waiting, my sister, you don't change your focus from the Lord. You focus on the city four square, the city whose builder and architect is God himself. You can work on things that are here in this world. You work on them. You do your best. But whatever you do does not derail you from the city four square. And so, what should keep you moving, what should keep you focused, is what John the Revelator said in the book of Revelation, chapter 22. Then he showed me a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, in the middle of its street. On either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruits, yielding his fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. There will no longer be any curse, for the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it. And his bond servants will serve him. They will see his face, and their names will be on their foreheads. And there will no longer be any night, for they will not need the light of the lamp, nor the light of the sun, for the Lord God will be with them. And they will reign forever and ever. Amen. And he said to me, these words are faithful and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, has shown to his bond servants things that must soon take place. And behold, I am coming quickly. Blessed is the one who heeds to the words of the prophecy of this book. I, John, saw and heard these things. And when I heard and saw these things, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed me. But he said to me, do not do that, for I am a fellow servant of yours and of your brethren, the prophets, and of those who heed the words of this prophecy. Worship God. That should be our task, brothers and sisters, to worship God. And he said to me, do not seal up the words of this, of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Let the one who does wrong still do wrong, and the one who is filthy still be filthy. Let the one who is righteous still practice righteousness, and the one who is holy still keep himself holy. Behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me to give to everyone according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter by the gates into the city. He who testifies to this thing says, yes, I am coming soon. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Jehovah hlonolofatse mme o boloki. Modimo a khantsa se fatlo sa hae ho wena mme a o hauhele. Modimo a tatimela hlakong la ha wa tanne mo leng teng mme o fe khotso. Khotso. E se ka mogolofatse le o fang ka teng. Khotso. E leng pao ya ka mogomo modimo o fang ka teng. Shall we pray together? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your message. We ask that you keep us patient in all our life challenges, and that things that we had given up hope on, you allow us to see them happening in our lifetime. Forgive us where we've done you wrong, and prepare us for your coming kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.